Hi everyone. Now we are going to discuss about syphilis, which is one of the type of sexually transmitted disease. That means this syphilis is going to be carried from person to person through the means of sexual contact. And this syphilis is going to be transmitted by a bacterium called as Treponema pallidum. This syphilis is a word that was derived from two Greek words, that is means syn means together and phallein means to love. The syphilis name is going to be from a poem published by Italian physician and poet Giramello Fracastoro in 1530, describing the legend of shepherd Syphilus who had been struck with the disease. So that's how the name of the syphilis has come. And the first saw in the year 71 to 1906, and the Paul E. Hoffman in the year 1868 to 1959 discovered this Treponema pallidum in the cancreas and in inguinal lymph nodes of syphilitic patients. That means these were the people who discovered this Treponema pallidum. Then what is the causative organism of the syphilis? So I already told you that the syphilis is going to be caused by a bacterium called as Treponema pallidum. So which means tripo means to turn and nema means thread-like. So that's how the name has come like this, Treponema pallidum. And this Treponema pallidum is going to belong to the family Spirochetaceae and the order Spirochetales. And it is a gram-negative bacteria. Okay, and coming to the morphology, that means the internal structure of this Treponema pallidum. The Treponema pallidum is going to be a very thin, delicate, motile, slender, flexible spirochete, twisted spirally along its axis with the tapering ends. And it is going to be of about 10 to 15 micrometers. In some books, it may be of 5 to 15 micrometers in length and about 0.15 or 0.2 micrometers in diameter. And the spirochete is going to possess about 10 regular spirals. So that means here, if you observe these spirals, if you count, those are going to be of approximately 10 regular spirals, which are going to be of a short and angular at regular intervals of what we call it as 1 micrometer distance. So that's how it is going to be of about 10 to 15 micrometers. So where it is going to possess the 10 spirals at a distance of 1 micrometer. And now it shows the motility by the rotation around the long axis by backward as well as the forward movements. And the flexion of the whole backward and this whatever the forward movements is going to be because of the flexion of the whole body. Okay, and during the motion, the secondary spirals or the curves are going to appear and disappear in succession, but the primary spirals are unchanged. So this can be of a little bit similar in the movements of like how a earthworm is going to come forward or backward. In the same manner, this is also going to move. Then coming to the ultrastructure, that is complete internal structure of this Treponema pallidum, is going to possess the cytoplasm inside, is going to be surrounded by 3 layers. So that's why I have written here it as a trilaminar cytoplasmic membrane is there, which is going to be enclosed with a cell wall containing peptidoglycan that provides a rigidity and the shape to the cell. Okay, so it is going to have the peptidoglycan layer and below which it is going to possess the 3 layers of cytoplasmic membrane, that is nothing but the plasma membrane. External to the cell wall, there is a lipid-rich outer membrane layer. Because it's a gram-negative bacteria, obviously it will have a lipid-rich outer membrane layer, but that is composed of glycosaminoglycans. Okay, so this is very important, glycosaminoglycans. Whereas in the other gram-negative bacteria, it is going to be of lipid A, that is polysaccharide-rich lipid polysaccharide is made up of the outer membrane, but here it is going to be composed of glycosaminoglycans. Between the cell wall and the outer sheath, there is going to be of some sort of what we call as these endoplasmic and exoplasmic are going to be present. So those are going to be of very important for this motility of this Treponema pallidum, which is going to show the corkscrew like manner, propeller, how a propeller is going to move. In the same manner, this Treponema pallidum is also going to have the motility. So the periplasmic flagella in bundles is known as endoflagella or exile filaments, which are going to anchor at both ends and do not protrude from the cell. That means the flagella are going to be of present inside of the cell but not outside. So that's why these are being called as endoflagella. So this ultrastructure of this Treponema pallidum is a little bit important to have the more questions on it. Then moving to the staining, that means how do you stain this Treponema pallidum and how we can observe it. Means the Treponema pallidum cannot be observed under the light microscope in wet films due to its weak refractivity and slender thickness. But these can be seen by negative staining with Indian ink. So that's a very important. So negative staining with the Indian ink, you can see like this. However, its morphology and motility can easily absorb under the dark field microscope or phase contrast microscope. Treponema pallidum is not going to be stained by ordinary bacterial stains, that is our gram staining, all those things, but it stains light rose red or pale pink with prolonged GIMSA staining. Okay, so if you are going to have some sort of a GIMSA staining, then it is going to show some sort of a light pink or light rose red colored stain. We can observe the organisms in such color. In dried preparation, that means complete dried preparations, the spirochetes needs to be thickened by silver impregnations methods, which is going to be of like Fontan's or Levadets, which are going to be used for identification, that is observation and staining of these, what we call as Treponema pallidum. Okay, so this is all about the observation and the staining. So you have to remember how you are going to observe and how they are going to be look in the microscopes, that is dark field microscope, phase contrast, and even the immunofluorescent microscopes. Cultivation. The Treponema pallidum, as well as the other pathogenic Treponema, cannot be cultivated in artificial culture medium that we are using routinely in our laboratories. But certain bacteria, that is Treponemas, are able to grow in co-cultivation with the tissue culture cells. And this growth of the spirochete can be maintained in motile and virulent form for about 2 weeks in complex media under anaerobic conditions. That is an important thing that we had. But recently, the virulent strains of Treponema pallidum has been maintained for many decades in rabbit tissues by serial testicular passages in the rabbit. So these are going to be cultivated in the testes of the rabbit from when it was isolated until now. And the virulent strains of this Treponema pallidum has been, as I told you, maintained in this one. And one such strain is going to be the Nicol strain, which was isolated from the brain of a fatal case of general paralysis of the insane in 1912. From then up to now, it is being continued of a serial testicular passage. This Treponema pallidum is being cultivated. And that's how we are going to have used for diagnostic and research purposes of this Treponema pallidum. Then resistance. The Treponema pallidum is readily inactivated in 1 hour by a heat of a temperature 41 to 42 degrees centigrade. And this is also going to be inactivated by contact with the oxygen, then distilled water, soap, arsenicals, then mercurial, common antiseptic agents and antibiotics. And the spirochete is going to be killed in about 1 to 3 days at a temperature of 0 to 4 degrees centigrade. The stored frozen at minus 70 degrees in 10% glycerol, or for example in liquid nitrogen at minus 130 degrees centigrade, we can store this Treponema pallidum. And it shows viability for about 10 to 15 years and provides a reliable source of antigens for immunological tests, whatever we are doing, the VDRL test, all those things. So that can be having by putting this Treponema pallidum at a temperature of minus 70 degrees centigrade in 10% glycerol, or at minus 30 degrees centigrade in the liquid nyrogen. So lyophilization kills the spirochete, so that is not going to be used to preserve this culture. So the best methods are liquid nitrogen preservation or the glycerol preservation. The inactivated soaps, arsenic, common antiseptic agents, these are all going to inactivate this Treponema pallidum. So this is all about the resistance of the Treponema pallidum. Then moving to the epidemiology. The syphilis is going to acquire through sexual contact, so that we know very well. That means it is going to be only by the means of sexual transmission, no other route. An infected person may remain contagious for about 3 to 5 years. So if a person once caught with this syphilis infection, that person may be having the 3 to 5 years of infection, and he can be a contagious, that means transmission of the disease to the others, for 3 to 5 years. The infected mother can transmit the infection to fetus in uterus through the placenta, but it is of a very rare in condition. And this is going to be an occupational hazard of medical personnel, and the disease is worldwide in distribution, and it is going to be a strict human parasite, and no extra human reservoir is known until now. Then moving to the pathogenesis and clinical features. The Treponema pallidum is going to enter into the body through mucous membranes or the minor breaks or the abortions of the skin at the genital regions during the sexual intercourse. The disease progresses in several stages that can span a period of 30 years or more. The disease syphilis occurs in 4 stages. The first stage is going to be called as primary stage. The second one is going to be the secondary stage, then latent stage, and the tertiary. So where we can call them as primary syphilis, then secondary syphilis, latent syphilis, and the tertiary syphilis. So here comes to the first primary stage. So in the primary stage, often an incubation period of about 10 days to 3 weeks, a painless canker develops at the infection site, which contains spirochete. So these are the painless lesions where you can see. That's why this is called as herpes lesions. Okay, so this herpes lesions are going to possess, or cankerins are going to possess the active spirochetes in it, and serological tests are going to be of what we call as positive in about 80% individuals during this stage. But in about 1/3 of the cases, the disease does not progress further and the cancerous disappears. But in the remaining cases, it leads to the secondary stage. So that is very important. Now, in the secondary stage, that means whatever the remaining 1/3 of the cases, if they enter into the secondary stage, here within 2 to 10 weeks after the primary lesions, the disease may enter the secondary stage, which is characterized by the skin rash that you are observing on the screen. And here both the cankery and the rash lesions are infectious. So this rash is going to be infectious, as well as the cankery is also going to be infectious. And the patients are 100% serologically positive at this stage. So if you test that person who's having these rashes and the cankery, those all results are going to be of 100% positive regarding the syphilis test. Then moving to the third test, third stage, that is going to be the latent stage. So after several weeks where the secondary lesions disappear and the disease is going to become latent, This state is going to be called as latent stage or latent syphilis. During this stage, the disease is normally infectious. That means it is not going to be that much infectious, except for the possibility of transmission from mother to the fetus, which is known as congenital syphilis. So here, obviously, what is the stage? The latent stage is the one where there may be of having the chance of congenital syphilis. But generally, the latent stage or the latent syphilis is not going to be of normally infectious. Then the last stage, that is tertiary stage. So after many years, the tertiary stage or the tertiary syphilis develop in about 40% of untreated individuals with secondary syphilis. So during this stage, a degenerative lesions called gummas form in the skin, bone and nervous system as a result of hypersensitivity reactions. So involvement of central nervous system may lead to the mental retardation, blindness, a shuffled walk and insanity. So these are all the symptoms that are being arised or effects are being arised because of this last stage, that is tertiary stage. So just have a glance of this chart where you can see. So after inoculation, it is going to have the primary syphilis. And then after 2 to 12 weeks, after appearance of the cankering, it may enter into the secondary syphilis. That means only one third, but the rest of the people are not going to have this one. So the secondary syphilis is going to lead to the latent syphilis. After 3 to 8 weeks, lesions disappear spontaneously. But out of the some of the people, 25% of patients replace within the first 1 to 2 years, and this is the stage where it is going to be contagious. Then if enters into the latent phase, it may enter into the secondary phase, or it can no reoccurrence due to the treatment. They are going to be avoid of this, that means recover from the syphilis disease. But the rest of the things, it may reoccur after 2 to 20 years. That may be between the 2 to 20 years, there may be a chance of having the tertiary syphilis, where you can see the gummas, hypersensitivity, damage of the things, everything. Okay, so that's all about the pathogenesis of syphilis. Then moving to the laboratory diagnosis, I have told you that how you are going to identify in the microscope is all these things. So if you see here in the dark field microscope, you are able to see them with of light organisms, the spirochetes, and here in the fluorescent microscope with the immunofluorescence staining, you can see them like this. Okay, so during the primary and secondary stages, the treponemas can be demonstrated either by the dark field microscopic examination or by the immunofluorescence staining from tissue fluid or the exudate taken from the cankering. Serological tests are the mainstay and very informative in the diagnosis of the syphilis. Number one, serological test for non-treponemal antibodies. So we know this is a general test, that is VDRL test, viral disease research laboratory test, then RPR card test, that is a rapid plasma reagent card test, and the Wasserman test, that is nothing but the complement fixation test. So these are the non-treponemal antibodies test. Then serological test for treponemal antibodies test are going to be of fluorescent treponemal antibody, then treponemal pallidum immobilization test, then treponema pallidum hemagglutination test. So these are the certain serological tests which are used to identify this syphilis disease. Then prevention and control. So how can we prevent and how can we control means? The prevention of syphilis is possible by the avoidance of sexual contact with the diseased individual. So use of physical barriers and antiseptics. Prompt and adequate treatment of all new cases. This is very important because these people may be contagious to the other, and follow up on sources of infection and contact so they can be treated. Now the treatment is going to be by using the penicillin mainly. Sometimes erythromycin or tetracycline may be used in penicillin allergic cases. Even ceftriaxone is also used in neurosyphilis cases. So this is all about the syphilis disease. Thank you.